He's still prettier than I imagined.
He does have a bunch of posters.
I guess that's the criteria now.
You hear me? I'm the homosexual.
Good evening, weirdos, and welcome to another edition of Living Cruddy with Cruddy Joe. I am Cruddy Joe, and I'm here once again with Wind Beneath My Wings, the Getty Along Gang. We have Handsome Jimmy Hansen, the Fool Wizard, Gino Royd Coffinberry. Our guest tonight is a system administrator, the third hunkiest man in Rutherford County, and an alleged creep ass. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Mr. John Cresap. Good evening, sir.
Thank you. Honored to be here.
I don't think that's alleged.
Confirmed creep ass?
Oh, definitely.
How do we say your last name?
It's Cresap.
Yeah, Cresap. Like ketchup.
No, I have never been called creep ass, but I thought that was a pretty good nickname, honestly.
Maybe I was dyslexic that day. Last week was the weirdest because it just like went all over the damn place. I'm sure people watching are like, what the fuck is this shit?
Gene went 3 hours down memory lane.
The G.G. Allen stuff was really fascinating.
Yeah.
I'm actually surprised we never talked about that before.
Yeah, I was looking up some G.G. stuff on YouTube. There's actually some G.G. Allen spoken word, so you don't get all the loud music in the way of him beating up women in the audience, pooping on the floor.
I mean, that was all a persona, right? And there's no way he was actually like that in real life, was he?
But he was pretty much like that in real life. It got worse over the years, but the thing that I gathered from talking to the dudes in the band was like they were all fucking terrified of him. And they were like, if you don't do anything else, do not fall asleep around that motherfucker. You're going to wake up with a disease or you're going to be on fire.
Or both.
Go away. We were trying to establish earlier how you found your way to the Cruddy Joe show. What happened?
My wife and I lived in Alabama, and we moved back to Tennessee last year, actually right before the whole pandemic happened. I was really just looking around for stuff like movie clubs, horror clubs, and I found the Tennessee Horror Club. And I remember the first thing that I saw, but it wasn't The Crawling Eye. It was a movie where they go into a cave, and then they come out, and there's a lot of lunch scenes. Like, they keep going back and making lunch at like a picnic table.
Oh, the brain from Planet Eris?
Yes.
Really sweaty guys?
Yes, that was it.
That's it? That's the brain from Planet Eris for sure.
Yeah.
There was a cave and they must have a cave in every one of those fucking movies then, because we also watched the crab monsters and the It Conquered the World. Is that what it is? Where they end up in a cave and they come back and they have like shit attached to the back of their head. And,
no. I remember Undertaker and his pals, that one. I knew then when I saw that one, I was like, okay, I know they're going to show some cool shit. And that sort of reminded me of like a Herschel Gordon Lewis thing. So yeah, I just kind of stumbled in from there. I mean, it's one of those things. I remember watching it and I showed my wife, holy shit, they're doing a watch party. Where I grew up, I mean, it was none of that. So it's kind of cool to see this. Well, I grew up for 29 years. I lived in Mississippi, went to college, was making movies with friends. We actually made a Slenderman movie, a total dog shit. I'll be honest. It's not a good
stuff. Where do we get a copy?
That's right. I want
to
see it.
It's actually on YouTube. I used to be kind of an actor. I did that for years and I did some extra work. I'm going to get shit for this. The biggest thing I ever did was Twilight, but that was like 10 years ago. I was a Volturi.
That's a big one, man. Bigger than anything we've been in.
Were you Edward Cullen?
Yes, he was.
He was nice. I remember he was very short though. He was like literally like 5'1" or 5 feet tall. He was like so short. Working on a set like that, the one thing I learned is just, it made me realize I was more of a fan than an maker, because sitting on a set for 12 hours like that day after day, not fun.
No bueno.
I realized I didn't love it as much as I thought I did at that point.
Well, I went one round of filmmaking as an extra, and that was that Tim Ritter thing, and I was like, no fucking way. Not even to have a featured scene, fuck this. It was like just the most boring shit that I ever did. I would go back and do music score stuff. That to me was much more fun. Problem is, just like anything, your shit just gets taken and used, and you have no control over it. We didn't even bring it up with Debbie Roshan, that Debbie stars in a movie. 100% of the score of that movie is done by the Creeping Cruds. She doesn't even know that this movie probably fucking exists.
Which movie is it?
It's called Red Lips Eat the Living. They named the movie after the song I Eat the Living that we do.
Wow.
Horrible fucking movie. I'm guessing that the Slender Man movie you're in was like Academy Award next to this fucking piece of shit.
Slender Man was horrible. We did like a rape revenge movie. We did a comedy. We did the most random shit. Now, whenever I moved to Tennessee, I just kind of transitioned out of that. I'm more of a fan now. It taught me what I love about it, but what I don't love about it, if that makes sense.
I was only in one movie, and that was a home movie with Jimmy's mom.
Jimmy's mom's getting a lot of play this last 2 weeks.
I have the movie Junkie John. I write reviews sometimes. I've always wanted to open my own movie theater. That's kind of my dream. That would be like the perfect job, I feel like, is just like running a movie theater.
Well, before we did this, we were getting together and watching movies. And this almost probably was the child of that we were doing a live thing. It was just too complicated trying to get people to come out. Joe started up this whole watch party thing online, and that seemed to be much more successful and much more easy to access than what we were doing then.
I remember there was a horror meetup. It was on that, I forget the site. I think it was called Meetup. And there was like a, yeah. And I think they used to go to the Regal at Green Hills.
The guy that ran that was actually one of the members of our club. And I never really met the guy, but I assumed that he was just doing it to keep tabs that we weren't stealing his people. That thing all fell through too.
Being in my mid-30s, like, you know, I see like a midnight showing on like Friday or Saturday, and I could drive out or just watch it on my TV. It's kind of lame. But as I'm past my late 20s,
it doesn't get any better.
Which leads me to the question, why is it John shows up to a movie, stays 20 minutes, and he's like, I got to go to bed?
A lot of that is me working. I work after hours a lot. Sometimes I have to do after hours work with IT. So I might be on the watch party and I've got to go do something. Of course, also, I do too many things. But I try to always cut out time like Wednesdays and Fridays. I like you guys' stuff. You're always entertaining and your interviews. So that's kind of my priority is usually the creeping cred stuff.
Awesome.
Does your wife like these kind of movies?
Oh, no. No. She's very much more into like drama and suspense. She would probably rather watch Sophie's Choice or something than like, you know, watch some of this stuff.
I'd rather watch Barry's Choice.
What is your favorite Freddy Joe flick to this point?
Probably Trick or Treat.
Really?
You know, I knew about, I never saw it. And when I watched it like 30 minutes in, I was like, oh shit, this is awesome. I've got to buy this.
Wait, you mispronounced things.
Have you endured things? I'm trying to establish who watched that and if there's anybody else that actually likes it.
I think I saw things. I'm pretty sure. Not to steal from Vinny, but I mean, I did like Children Should Play with Dead Things. I mean, that's awesome.
Where's it on your list?
On the top 1,000?
Where's Vinny on your list? On the top 500 watch party members?
Vinny's definitely in the top 5. Absolutely. Yeah.
Why specifically did you give Crater Lake Monster 4 stars?
Because Crater Lake Monster is worth 4 stars.
Well, that's Lisa's favorite, right? Have you guys ever tried to interview, I know this is probably ridiculous to ask, but have you ever thought about trying to reach out to Werner Herzog? He feels like the kind of guy that would do an interview, but it just depends on the mood.
Probably nicer than you expect, but in a cordial way, not as in like cool way.
We have a foundation. Maybe we can go through that. Maybe we'll make a big donation to his foundation and then see if we can get an interview.
What's his foundation?
Believe it or not, the Werner Herzog Foundation.
Oh, awesome. Well, there you go.
Now, I see a lot of your Texas Chainsaw Massacre posters back there. Are you at all looking forward to the remake?
God, I hope it's so good. I know it's not going to be good.
It won't be, yeah. It's like Lucy holding a football for Charlie Brown. Maybe this is going to be good, and it never is. I walk on, I'm like, okay, why did I waste my life on that?
I would love to see more Leatherface and all that stuff. I mean, it would be great if all those guys are still alive. It's just, you can't, it's like lightning in a bottle. I'll watch it, but I don't have high hopes for it at all.
Well, you take a story out of its element, and you add in all the modern bullshit that they do that make it look like every other fucking movie they do now. So what you get is a movie that looks like every other fucking movie they do now.
Another bad sign is I saw an article about that Texas Chainsaw Massacre remake. It goes, they now have the actual title for this movie. It'll be called Texas Chainsaw Massacre. I'm like, wow, well.
Amazing.
I like time on that one.
We removed the.
Yeah, we removed the.
What did you think about the Evil Dead remake?
I actually loved it. I know Vinny, I talked to him, I think it was on Instagram about this, because I tagged him at something, and he was like, this is shit. And I was like, I kind of liked it. For what it was, it reminded me a little bit of Evil Dead 1. It's better than the Fog remake.
Anything's better than the Fog remake.
I walked into the original Evil Dead when it ran in whatever, 83 or 84, having no idea what the fuck that was. It was just some shit that was playing at the theater. My two other friends had to leave because they couldn't take it. People weren't used to seeing that shit. I think it was right around the time that the pencil went into the ankle. That's when they're like, I'm fucking out. I'm like, I am definitely not leaving, motherfucker. So I'll see you at the mall. The first one was actually Morristown. And if anybody wants some official Evil Dead 1 merchandise, I have plenty of it. Take it right from the actual site. we can work out a deal. I like the series much more than that remake movie. I thought it was more fun and more in touch with the original flavor.
Oh, God. That first episode, I love that show. My wife, I remember I was binging that show, and she didn't at the time. We had only been married for like a year, so she wasn't quite aware of the depths of fandom of
some. Who are you?
So she was introduced to Evil Dead like, wow, this is very fucking interesting. It sucks that Stars canceled it. I mean, they put on so many fucking shows for like 18 seasons, and then you get one that's good, and it's...
You can base whether something's going to be canceled off of how fucking expensive is it to do the set, and how involved is it to maintain the set. So you're going to have shows like that and Deadwood, and any place that has like a unique thing that they have to keep going for a couple years, they're always going to strike those shows first. And unfortunately, shows like the Evil Dead show, you know, they get ended before you find out what happens.
I thought that The True Detective, the season one, that was a fucking fabulous show.
Yeah,
I loved the first season, did not like the second season, but I did like the third season. Yeah. Steven Dorff, that motherfucker knocks it out of the park in that season three. He's very good.
Wasn't that him and Dorff on golf too?
Dorff.
Yeah, Steven Dorff on golf. There's actually a really good movie with him and Val Kilmer where they end up in a prison and they have to fight like these badass Mexicans, which sounds ridiculous, but it's actually a really good movie. I don't know what it's called, but look through his IMDb and dig that up. It's a really good flick.
Is it called Badass Mexicans?
Called Badass Mexicans versus Dorff on golf.
Val and Dorff versus Badass Mexicans.
John, as a system administrator, are you the guy that would rat me out to my boss that I was spending too much time surfing the internet instead of doing my work?
I'm the guy who, if you're looking at porn, I'm like putting up the messages as you look at the porn site. It's like, what are you doing, you perv?
Yeah, but from you, it'd be like, no, this is the better site. Then you give me a URL.
I've been doing IT forever. I like it. I don't love it, but it's funny. People will have like file shares, so I have all their stuff at work, and I'll keep personal stuff there. You wouldn't believe the shit people put on their work shared drives. Horrible. Like some of the things that I found that I've had to delete, and it's always the same thing, because you delete it and you're like, okay, so if this person is smart, they will never ask me about what happened to this stuff. Sure enough, there's that one asshole who's like, hey, I had some videos here. Do you know where they are? What's on them?
The FBI has them.
Yeah.
You're saying don't use your work computer for this kind of shit. Deleting stuff after we're done here.
Well, you know what they say, you can't have shit without IT.
It's provided a living, but it can be stressful.
No. It's funny though, in all the office environments I've worked at, and that's a lot of places, some of the most bitter guys I've ever met were in IT. I don't know. I mean, they're so entitled, yeah. Angry, and bitter. I don't know if they're incels or what. I don't know what their deal was.
It's all that.
I worked with a lot of assholes. I definitely know the type.
Yeah, our IT guys are probably pretty good, but I also know how to dance around the shit that would set them off, too. I can definitely see where your average office person would try to communicate with them. Office people, they don't come into the world with the same set of knowledge.
No. It's not office space level. I've never had that experience, but I've had similar experiences to office space. Probably the scariest experiences ever I've had working in IT. Like, I actually had to go one time work at a data center in Philadelphia, and it was at like 1 a.m. I had to get out there. I grew up near Memphis, so I kind of thought, you know, I know rough neighborhoods. So I go up to Philadelphia and I get out of the car, and I swear to God, the first thing I think is fucking Escape from New York. It's Escape from New York. There's like a burning trash can. There's like people running behind a building scattered. And I've got all this like server equipment I'm gonna carry in a building, and I'm thinking I'm gonna get shot and robbed. And that was the most terrified I've ever been.
There's some places that play themselves off as hard, like Memphis or Nashville or, you know, parts of Georgia and shit like that. But man, Philly is the real fucking deal. Yeah. Just like Detroit and parts of Jersey and DC, those places where you're like, okay, we got to put on our extra fucking game here.
That same night, I remember I walked in this place and there was a security guard. So I get in there and I've got all this shit. And then there's a homeless guy walking by, which is not a big deal. And the security guard stops and he goes, oh man, I got to mace another motherfucker tonight. Really? And I'm like, what is going on?
It's a Tuesday in Philly for you.
There's a place down in West Palm that I lived that was like was known as the worst little stretch. It was called Westgate. One time I was driving, coming home from work. It was pretty late. And I saw a dude chasing a big ass fat pig, like literally a pig. The guy had no clothes on. He was chasing the pig. And then that disappeared into the darkness. And then I went around the corner. It started lighting up. up and I got up to where the guy was and he was gone. Pig was gone. But there was a shopping cart like the ones you see at Target made out of plastic engulfed in flames. And the plastic was just melting onto the pavement. And it was like, this is fucking surreal, man. You can't imagine what that looks like at, you know, 1 o'clock in the morning until you're actually there looking at it.
They don't put that on the postcard, do they? It's all fucking Cocoa Beach.
Yeah.
There's no guy chasing a pig in a burning shopping cart.
They don't show the guy in the wheelchair getting in a fight with the guy on the bicycle in the middle of the fucking window.
Florida,
yeah.
We've definitely strayed here. What else do you have, Joe?
Do you ever see yourself taking Ben Wilkinson's crown and assuming the throne as king of Murfreesboro?
I hope so. He's got to live here long enough. He was from here, right?
Ben? He's a lifer, yeah.
Good I think you might be able to take him. He's pretty friendly. You can use that to your advantage.
Yeah, he's short. He's a little guy, man. I think
yeah.
You'll also have to take Scuffle Moss, but he's short too, so.
You take him.
Maybe they'll team up.
Murfreesboro is an interesting place. I like it, but it's like, what is the term? 10 pounds of shit in a 5-pound bag. you can't go anywhere here. There's so many people. If I go out, it's usually on a weeknight or really late. Yeah, it's just too many people here.
Man, every time I go over there, the fucking traffic is like, wow, this is more than it is here in Franklin.
Yeah, we came from Alabama in like a small town outside of Birmingham. We had a Dollar General near us and that was it. I tried to start something down there. It just didn't work out. I was trying to start this. It was called Central Alabama Monster Squad. Maybe 9 or 10 people joined, but it quickly fizzled out.
There's some people down there. It's just hard to make that kind of shit work, especially when you get into your 30s and 40s and shit, man. People are like trying to make their way with bills and stuff.
I think what you guys do here, though, I mean, like the Tennessee Horror Club and the Creeping Cruds, I mean, that's just fucking awesome, man. I cannot explain just how rare it is to see that. Like in Mississippi, it was like the people who were into film, subsection of a subsection of a subsection. Usually it's a lot of elitist assholes. What you guys have going, it's just so awesome, man. I'm so glad you guys do this every week.
Well, we appreciate it, man. I will say the center of the horror world in Nashville is still Dr. Gangrene. Everything has its tentacles come from that. Even the Creeping Cruds probably wouldn't have existed without that connection early on. We just knew we had something to build on.
So did you guys play, I mean, before the pandemic, you were playing shows. Were you doing watch parties in person ever?
We did the Nashville horror nerd thing, which we only probably did like 8 or 9 movie nights. But the big thing we did is the Horror Hootenanny, which was, you know, it was broken up last year by COVID, but this would have been number 18, Jimmy?
Yeah.
So the next one will be number 18. And that's a show between the Creeping Cruds and Larry. And it's all built around rock and roll and horror.
Well, that's all my questions if you want to segue into the quiz.
All right. So you're familiar with how this works, right?
Yeah, definitely.
I think Jimmy's having a hard time. He was either falling asleep or having a spasm.
I'm going to need some lifelines.
What are you doing there,
bro? There I am. Joe New.
There you go. All bad for that.
Well, now he's revealed that he's a vinyl collector.
I don't know what that means, though. You can be a vinyl
anything
collector.
From the Twins soundtrack, Gene. I think that's fair.
The weirdest thing is my first quote is from the movie Twins. Can you believe that shit?
Who sings the title track on that? It's the only song I know. We Are Twins, United, Outside, and In. Who did that, John?
I actually do not know who sings
the soundtrack.
Now, looking at what I've got here, I think you will fucking ace the movie shit very easily. Possibly the music. I just don't know what you're into with the music. I mean, that's the thing. So I went with like some kind of vague shit that I definitely would know that maybe these guys would know. As this goes, we do 6 of these. If you get all 6 of them, we have a 7th one on hand, and then you could be tied with Ben and the Queen of the Watch Party, Lisa. She did get through it. I'll say a couple lines from a song. All you have to do is tell me the next line, name of the band, name of the song. And if you don't know, you can reach out to one of our kick-ass lifelines here, Handsome Jimmy or Cruddy Joe. The first one, this might be the most difficult one of all of them. Are you guys ready too? Because you might have to help him out.
Oh, totally.
Ready.
Joe's like, fuck this. The lines from this song are, beware of the pool, the blue bottomless pool. It leads you straight right through the gate. What's the next line, name of the band, name of the song?
Can you sing it? Can you do some, give me something there a little bit? Do a little jig, something there.
I'm like, idiot fucking singing again.
No, it's good.
And it never sounds like it is what it's sung. Let me see if I can, it leads you straight right through the gate.
There's something there, but I don't think
that's a real song.
I'm thinking it's a group maybe that started from Georgia. Is it the B-52s?
Right. It sure is.
Is it My Own Private Idaho?
It sure is. It leads you straight right through the gate.
And then me and AG had to regulate.
That is incorrect. But he didn't ask you to tell him. So.
Well, he got pretty good there. He broke the code on most.
So we'll give him the point for that. It leads you straight right through the gate that opens on the pool, and then the next line is you're living in your own private Idaho.
Congratulations.
So you got one of one.
Oh, nice.
It's funny how this always happens. You guys got your game face on. That's Jimmy's game face.
He's looking like Hellraiser. Like he's gonna like pull the skin. And
all right, the next one. Fuzz Tone, hear him go. Hear him on the radio. Misfits, Twilight Zone. Next line, name of the band, name of the song.
One more time. What was that?
Fuzz Tone, hear him go. Hear him on the radio. Misfits, Twilight Zone. I'll give you a hint. The name of the song is the same as the next line.
Bring the noise.
Fuzz Tone, hear him go. Hear him on the radio. Misfits, Twilight Zone.
Cheap Trick.
No, we didn't do any Cheap Trick this week, Joe, because you ruined it last week.
Yeah. Nice job, Joe.
All right. Fuzz Tone, hear him go. Hear him on the radio. Misfits, Twilight Zone. R-A-M-O-N-E-S. R-A-M-O-N-E-S. Wow. Ramones. Tell me the band that did that, and then I'll give you the point.
Oh, it would be Motorhead.
It was Motorhead. Well, Jimmy did get it, and he is a lifeline. So.
Thank you, Jimmy.
Two for two, kind of. This next one is a great song, but I'm looking at it now going, man, I don't know if these motherfuckers will know this. The lyric is, we know of an ancient radiation that haunts dismembered constellations, faintly glimmered radio station. While Frank Sinatra sings Stormy Weather, the flies and spiders get along together. What is the next line, name of the band, name of the song?
Cheap Trick. I don't know the answer. Give me a clue.
The band is named after a dessert. They were a very unusual, unique, distinctive sounding rock band with an amazing fucking guitar player on the first record anyway.
Oh, Cake?
Cake.
It's not Going the Distance. God, it's like my wife's favorite band. Literally, that's one of her favorite bands.
What's a cake?
We know of an ancient radiation that haunts dismembered constellations while faintly glimmered radio station. While Frank Sinatra sings Stormy Weather, the flies and spiders get along together.
You guys are blinking too.
All right, then we've expired here. The band is Cake. The song is Frank Sinatra, and the line is "Cobwebs fall on an old skipping record." I can't believe that the three of you couldn't put that together.
Is that a band for real named after a cake? What are they? Why? Why do they? I don't know. As you'll learn on next week's podcast with our guest.
Yeah, remind me. One of my the questions I have to have is, why does Jimmy suck so much at remembering?
He'll be able to tell you.
All right. So we're 2-1. You're not going to win the all time, but you're still doing pretty good. And I think you can clean up pretty well on these movie quotes. Okay, here we go. Let's have some fun with this. Okay. The first quote is, there's a storm hitting us in 6 hours and we're going to find out who's who.
Storm hitting us in 6 hours.
There's a storm hitting us in 6 hours and we're going to find out who's who.
It almost feels like a Carpenter movie, but it's not. I don't think that is a Carpenter movie.
With the two you have there, you should be able to get.
All right, Joe, what do you think?
Is it The Thing?
It is The Thing.
So I was thinking, yeah.
Who says it?
MacReady? Does he say it?
Yes, MacReady says it. Thing. So in the quotes, you're 1-1. The next quote is, hey, Jesse, remember that fire we started in Chicago?
Oh, Near Dark, and it's Bill Paxton.
It's correct. Yes,
wow. 2-2. Wow, slam dunk.
Yeah, I was hoping somebody would get that one. Here's another one. This is a classic one. I crack up every time I hear this. She's a real carpenter's dream, flat as a board, and she needs a screw.
I think it's a slasher movie.
She's a real carpenter's dream, flat as a board, and she needs a screw.
That's not Sleepaway Camp, is it?
It is. Who says it?
What's her name? The main girl. I forget her name.
Just describe her and you'll get the point.
The girl with the ponytail that like puts out. And she hates Angela. She picks on Angela. Like,
yeah, she's got really long hair and her name is Judy.
Yeah, Judy. Yeah.
Okay. 3-3. This one's a slight departure from the other ones. Great. Another great quote that fucking I think has disturbed a lot of people over the years. The quote is, speaking of Jack, one-eyed Jack's yearning to go a peeping in a seafood store. What movie is that and who says it?
What was that?
Speaking of Jack, one-eyed Jack's yearning to go a peeping in a seafood store.
Elvis said it.
Actually, there is an Elvis connection, but
Wild at Heart.
Whoa, Jimmy just gave you the name of the movie.
Did I?
Yes.
Oh, is it Willem Dafoe says?
It sure is. Bobby Peru.
Okay. Awesome.
Look at that. You guys sorted it out. So in the end, out of 7, you got 6. So that's not bad.
Nice.
What's a cake? Is that a band?
Cake is a band.
Well, I have an unofficial question. What year was Amory, Mississippi founded?
Early 1820s?
1887. Wrong.
Oh, wow, 60 years off.
John, can you sing Old Man River for us?
Is that going to be a new segment? Joe's going to ask somebody to sing a song.
I think so.
I could. Jimmy, sing Best Friend's Girl.
Spare us that, please. So we're on to Nad Libs. Joe took a different approach this week on this and made what has to be the shortest Nad Lib. They were getting longer and longer, and now he's cut it way back. I'm assuming that this is going to be concentrated humor here. Is that what we can expect, Joe? Because I haven't read it.
It's a laugh a second.
First thing I need is something that you can fly on, whatever the fuck that means. Does that mean magic, like a magic carpet? Does that work, Joe? Go. A handheld electronic device. A
vibrator.
A synonym for crazy.
Psychotic.
A synonym for dirty.
Nasty.
A shady establishment.
A massage parlor.
One of the freak out regulars.
Vinny.
It changes it from Vinny to vinyl. Your favorite Sesame Street character.
Bert.
Your favorite candy.
Eat bar.
Your favorite hot beverage.
Coffee.
A theater employee.
Usher, concessionist, projectionist, something like that.
Or projectionist. There you go. I worked in a movie theater, so I was like, what's...
I did for 12 years, John.
Wow. I did for 3 months. That was actually the worst job I ever had, believe it or not.
Wow.
Joe and Creep Bats are going to have a fist fight here. I guess.
Yep, here it comes.
What is this, your favorite Barry Gillis movie? Is that what that one is? Things.
Good answer. Best answer. Survey says 10 of 10.
Your second favorite candy.
Snickers.
They really satisfy.
And your favorite insect.
Praying mantis.
I think I got them all here. You want to read this, Jimmy, or am I doing this?
I would be happy to read it for you if you'd like.
All right, you got it. I don't have to read anything tonight.
Oh, my God. Tonight's story, John sets out for revenge. John disembarked from the magic carpet, having just returned from Ireland, where he attended the funeral service for the recently murdered Lisa Monaghan. John jumped when his vibrator buzzed with a text message. The message asked if John really wanted to see COVID zombies. Since John is not psychic, he immediately replied that they could go fuck themselves. A map, however, John then took it upon himself to investigate Lisa's mysterious demise. Using the map, John soon found himself on the nasty side of Murfreesboro. Is there a nasty side? There, he found a theater next to a massage parlor. Outside the theater, Vinny was handing out masks. John chose a Bert mask. Inside, John was approached by handsome Jimmy's mom. And for a second, John thought he had accidentally stepped into a brothel. Of course you did, John, because where else would my mother be? After shunning her advances, John then went to the concession stand and got a bucket of hot buttered Heath bars and an ice cold coffee. When the projectionist tried to direct John to the theater showing Corona zombies, John promptly suggested that they go fuck themselves and instead went to the theater showing Things. Unfortunately, 5 minutes into the movie, John's head exploded, releasing 1 pound of Snickers and 2 pounds of praying mantis. Despite John's best intentions of avenging Lisa's death, he instead became another victim of having his corpse teabagged by Hugh Jackman. Okay. Hugh Jackman was clearly shoehorned into that story, Joe.
Your mom got shoehorned in that story.
Everybody's busy shoehorning into Jimmy's mom. How do we get Ben's mom in this story?
Yeah, why isn't Ben's hot mom in the story?
Because Joe can't say anything nice about people's moms.
Remember some nice titties on Jimmy's mom. That's a nice thing to say.
That is a nice thing.
Last I checked, right. Joe was the one that said that in the last.
I stole that joke.
Because I knew that she was lived in America at one point, but something I just, when she spoke, that was like not at all what I was expecting. I was so expecting like the British accent and everything.
You talking about Lisa?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Expected more of a brogue.
Yeah. She sounds like the nanny. Hoi!
I might do like a top 100, like, shittiest movies I bought at Dollar Tree.
Well, chicks dig it. Everyone knows physical media drops the panties.
Oh, yeah. They love that. You're going through your pile.
They love going through my piles. Well, if you're down there looking at my ring, might as well take the time and take a peek.
Ooh. You're disgusting. All right. Do we have a Jimmy's Cruddy Cuisine this week?
Not only do we have a Cruddy Cuisine this week, we have one that I've kind of been hesitant to do because my pancake recipe is so solid and so good. But this week, I really wanted to share it with everybody. So let's go to the clip.
Finally, my pancake recipe, which is top secret. This was filmed with a security camera in my own kitchen. You can see there I'm breaking the eggs. This recipe requires 2 eggs to be sort of massaged while you're holding a glass of milk. That can be skim milk or 2%. It depends on your dietary needs, but you have to kind of scooch the egg around, maybe roll the whisk in it, I guess, and then scoochy scooch, and then you're going to get some baby powder maybe or something and put it in a sifter. Yeah, sift some flour. That's what that is. That's flour, right? Yeah, you're going to put some flour, I guess, in a bowl, sift. I guess the eggs might be in there. Oh, hold on. A lady will come in and help you. And then you should not eat the raw batter because it has egg in it. Don't do... Okay, good. He's just rolling it like a booger. And then you put it on a hot skillet, like drippy drip like that. And ooh, yeah, that's delicious. And then I guess you got to let it cook or something while some bitch drinks coffee and she's like, where's my fucking pancakes? And you're all, they're right here. Here you go. Here's my pancakes. And then this happens. I like your pancakes, baby. Oh, I wanna taste your pancakes. Everybody loves those motherfucking pancakes.
Lean gray bodies with large heads and manes of long white hair came piling out of the foliage. Their high-pitched screams were almost in unison. Vern froze as one ran right by his little brother, completely ignoring him. It was Grandma Brudabaker. Vern had always been terrified of his great-grandmother. She had a thin, emaciated body. Her bulbous head was precariously balanced on top of a spindly, vein-riddled neck like a macabre Q-tip. Amazingly, her hair had receded like a man's. Only a straggly white crown remained, and it draped across the entirety of her back like a cape. Grandma Brudabaker's face was gone. She hardly ate anything due to the golf ball-sized ulcers in her stomach. Her skin was scarred from years of overexposure to the sun. To a 5-year-old boy, Grandma Brudabaker was a monster. And now, years after her demise, her actions finally coincided with her appearance. Vern watched in dumb horror as Grandma sped across the open field, leapt high into the air, then came crashing down upon the shoulders of a woman in her mid-40s, bending her body into an unnatural U. For the life of him, Vern couldn't remember his grandmother having such large, strong legs. She didn't stop there. Grandma grabbed a pretty girl in a bright orange sundress and threw her into a man holding a chihuahua with enough force to knock them both back 15 feet without touching the ground. She then picked up one of the yard attendants and threw both him and his leaf blower through the windshield of a Pontiac several yards away. With the grace of a large cat, Grandma once again took to the air, landing on the hood of the Pontiac with a terrific thud, springing through the broken glass into the front seat. She's eating him.
Well, I just wanted to let you know that that is not how you cook a steak. Sorry, man. You've lost a few points. You don't put the steak on and then go back and work on your potatoes for a fucking half an hour.
Oh, no. There was only 7 minutes on the steak. That wasn't true time. No.
There was so much stuff about the potatoes. I forgot that there was a steak cooking.
It was like potato, 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 potato. But then he goes out and he like flips these fucking
flaming steaks. I was trying a new technology where I attached the camera to my head, videoed my whole night of me cooking. It was like 2 hours of footage of me putting this meal together.
You've almost created a genre called cooksploitation.
Let's see what kind of shenanigans Vinny's getting into this week. What's up, Vinny?
Well, folks, I told you that I would have a celebrity this week, and I'm not lying. I had to use an Ouija board to get him, but he's here. I present to you Mr. Casey Kasem.
Hi, I'm Casey Kasem for Vinny's Monster Minute. I'm dead, but that doesn't matter. Now, we're up to this week's installment. I was the voice of Shaggy and Robin on Super Friends. Lance Henriksen stars as a backwoods fellow who gets revenge on some city folks for killing his only child. I was the thing with two heads, and it's not even on Vinny's goddamn list. Lance invokes a demon named Pumpkinhead, and all hell breaks loose. It debuted in 1988, and it hits the list at number 18. It's Pumpkinhead on Vinny's Monster Minute. I'm Casey Kasem. Keep your feet on the ground and your hands on your junk.
Casey's Coast to Coast.
I gotta talk about a fucking dog dying.
Hey, McNasty, who has the better body of work? George Romero or Caesar Romero? I'm a sock for puppetry, not jizz, you son of a bitch!
Nothing against the Joker or the Cisco Kid, but I'm going to have to go with George on this one.
We should tell our people to keep an eye out for Movie Junkie John's reviews on your social media.
And I will post the link to the page, and there'll be definitely more coming soon. Maybe even a review for Things.
Awesome. Well, that's all we got for you tonight, weirdos. I want to thank my pals, The Wind Beneath My Wings, The Getty Along Gang, Handsome Jimmy Hansen, and the full wizard, Gino Roy Coffinberry. Most importantly, I'd like to thank our very special guest, Mr. Becca Cresap. Thank you, Becca, for your time this evening.
His name is John Creepass.
Thank you, John. Am I being fired?
We just got to make sure you've done your work. That's all.
Wait, Gene, you didn't tell him yet? Don't feel bad, Jimmy. I'm getting fired, too. I'm doing Zoom interviews all weekend. What are you talking about?
Joe's ready for bed now.
Does that mean I'm the homosexual?
Radiation that parts dismembered constellations, a faintly glimmering radio station. While Frank Sinatra sings stormy weather, the flies and the spiders get along together. Cobwebs fall on old skipping records.
Associated with you.